If you were here in the 9:30 Sunday school hour, that the doctrinal study notes are all going to be available online through the church app, and so definitely check those out if you weren't able to make it this morning. And good morning to everybody who's watching on Facebook, YouTube. For anybody who's new to South High Community Church today, I want to extend a welcome to you as well. It's great to have you guys here. I'm Pastor Barry McLaughlin, and my dad is Barry McLaughlin Sr., of course, Barry the Elder. I'm Barry the Younger, or Barry the Lesser, as some say, who don't like me very much. But today's message, I really hope, is going to be one that's going to lift our spirits as we get into this new year. That's going to be the focus of today. Today's message is entitled, The Newness of Life. And I really want to focus on the idea today that those of us who are believers in Jesus Christ are a new creation, brand new. And I want to really get that emphasized today throughout the passages and different things that we look at. Thomas Jefferson, our third president of the United States, said this. He said, "I like the dreams of the future better than the history of the past." And you think for us today, how many of us can relate to that? Thinking towards the future, towards the next year, leaving the past year that in many ways was, for many of us, in different ways and challenges, a difficult time. But he says, "I like the dreams of the future better than the history of the past." And how much more applicable could that be to today? And so I want you guys to turn to 1 Peter 1, 6, and 7, because I want to read something to you that the Apostle Peter wrote. Now, this will not actually be our primary text today, but it is going to set the ground for what we're talking about, the focus, the central focus of today's point. And that is the idea of challenges. Again, this past year, many of us have suffered loss. There's been financial heartaches. We've had shutdowns. We've seen things unprecedented that many of us never thought would happen. But, you know, Peter had a lot to say to his audience that was reading his epistle. And he writes about the fiery trials. Notice what he says in 1 Peter 1, 6, and 7. He says, "In this you greatly rejoice," talking about the trials, "though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials." Now notice the purpose, "that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ." And so the focus of today is not going to be necessarily on the trials themselves. You know, we've preached on that this past year many times. But our focus is going to be, how do we live in spite of the trials? How do we live in this new year for Christ? What does it mean to live for Jesus Christ? But notice verse 7. The purpose of trials is to test the genuineness or the authenticity of our faith. It is to, as the metalsmith does, you know, putting gold through the fire to cook out all the impurities. That is why God puts us to the fire with trials. And you know, sometimes it's easier to preach that than it is to actually live that out. And when you experience hardship, you know, this past week with the passing of my grandmother and then obviously the loss that we faced in our church, it's easy to say these things, but then when we experience these things as individuals in a church, we have to realize that God puts us through these things for a purpose, to sharpen our faith, not to destroy us, but to make us stronger. And that's what I want to focus on today. And in fact, Dr. Henry Morris writes this, in fact, in his little daily devotional. He says, and this was written on December 31st, just to give you some context, "As we come to this year's end, it is salutary for the believer to think back over the days of the year and to meditate upon his or her blessings. He or she may indeed have experienced defeats and losses, disappointments and injuries in great number. If he or she is honest with themselves, however, the Christian will always have to acknowledge this, that God is even working in and through all the trials and hurtful things together for our good," Romans 8:28. So those are the things that we have to remember, that God is sovereign. He is in control, and he has never left the throne. Though it sometimes seems he isn't there, God is always present. And so if you'll turn with me today to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we're going to be looking at verse 12 to start. But as you're turning to that, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I want to pick up on a theme here, or an idea that Paul actually mentions in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and that is the idea that as we're thinking about living in this new year, living for Jesus Christ, we understand that Jesus is going to return. And we're not going to go here, but Revelation 22, 12, it was mentioned in Sunday school. And in those passages, Jesus says, "Behold, I come quickly, my reward is with me. I'm going to give to each one according to their works." And so we understand that as we live through these difficulties and trials, we have that hope. And that's what Peter means when the verses we just read, in 1 Peter when it says the revelation of Jesus Christ. It means that Jesus is coming back. Those of us who are in Christ have that hope that we are going to be resurrected from the dead and that we have unconditional eternal life that can't be lost and that Jesus is going to reward us greatly for our obedience to him.
Amen.
But if you look at 2 Corinthians contextually here before we read our passage, we have to understand that the church of Corinth was any church like you would see today, like a church of, like, as an example, like a church of 10,000 people. They had seemingly on the surface everything going on. They were wealthy, filthy rich. They had a lot of different aspects to their church. But the problem that Paul found was that he looked past the outside appearance and he said, you have these issues in your church. 1 Corinthians was written to address all of these types of immorality, divisions in their church, all of these heresies and things that were happening, people taking Greek philosophy and bringing it into the church. Now, after Paul left, it seems to be that these problems were pretty well corrected. After he wrote the first letter to the Corinthians, it seems to be that they corrected these things, the different immoralities. But unfortunately, after Paul left, there was a group of people, false teachers, who came into the church, and they basically undermined Paul's teachings. They said, Paul is out of his mind. He's beside himself, as Paul would say. Those are the wordings that he might use. He's beside himself. You shouldn't listen to the things that he's telling you. Listen to us. But as we read in this chapter, as we're going to read, they were teachers who were more focused on the material. They were focused on the outside appearance. They were focused on all of these types of things, selfish gain. But Paul was focused on building the church up. And so that's why Paul is addressing the church in 2 Corinthians, is to refute these false teachers, but also to affirm, reaffirm what he's taught them. And so notice what the apostle writes in 2 Corinthians 5:12. It says, "For we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you opportunity to boast on our behalf, that you may have an answer for those who boast in appearance and not in heart." That's the false teachers, of course. "For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. Or if we are of a sound mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new." And so I'm gonna open us up here again just in a word of prayer, and then we'll jump into this text and break it down verse by verse. Dear Heavenly Father, please help us to understand what's really getting at in 2 Corinthians 5:17. In context of the chapter, some of the stuff, you know, gets complicated as we look at Greek words and things, Lord. But I pray, God, that you would open our hearts to understand what you'll have us to learn. And we just give this passage reading and this breakdown into your hands in Christ's name. Amen. And so what we see here, as I just read, 2 Corinthians 5 lays out, if you will, the goal of the Christian life. If you notice in verse 15, what is the goal of the Christian life? It says that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. The very purpose of the Christian walk is to live for Jesus Christ, to bring him glory. In fact, we see that everything in creation was created to bring God glory. And people oftentimes ask, why was humanity created? Was God lonely? Did he need company? The answer is no. Obviously, we understand that the Trinity, they had eternal fellowship in eternity past. God wasn't lonely. He didn't need us to not be, you know, lonely and sad. It's the idea that God created humans. God created everything in creation so that we might bring him glory. And we are to do that as Christians by living for him who died for us. So I'm going to share with you two principles that we can extract from this passage, two principles about living for Christ. I'm going to call living for Christ our spiritual goal for 2021. That's going to be like our spiritual goal that we should all strive for. As Paul strived for the crown, it's the idea that we're going to strive to live for Jesus Christ. And so I'm going to share with you two principles from this passage that I think can really get us moving in the right direction towards living for Jesus Christ. And the first principle we're going to be is actually going to be found in verse 17. The first principle is that to reach our spiritual goal, we must fully understand the new life. You know, catch that. To reach our spiritual goal, we must fully understand the new life. And I'm going to explain what I mean by this in a second. But look back at verse 9 through 11. Notice what it says in verse 9 through 11 of chapter 5. It says, therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to him. So that's, again, the goal, to be well-pleasing to Christ. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but are well-known to God, and also trust are well-known in your consciences. And so what we understand is that, yes, we are a new creation in Christ. We've been given eternal life. But as Christians, we have to remember that there is a time when Jesus Christ is coming back. And there is a time when us as believers will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And that's what it's talking about here. There will come a time when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and he will evaluate us on our works. Even though we have this newness of life, and that's why Paul puts this in here to remind them. But then he gets to the hope in verse 17, the idea of what this new life is. And I'll tell you this, in order to live for Jesus Christ, we have to have an understanding of what the new creation is in verse 17. Charles Stanley says this, in order to live for him, that would be, actually I'm reading the wrong line, I'm sorry. I'm going to read one line up. Charles Stanley says this, the new birth experience is a fresh beginning. And so when you think of this, it's the idea that you've been made, if you believe in Jesus Christ and receive eternal life, you have been made brand new. You are an absolute new creation. And we're going to talk about the mechanics of that in a second. But it's super important to realize that in order to live for him, we must understand who we are now in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to give an example. I really hope this isn't too cheesy. But if you like Disney movies, if you've seen the movie The Lion King, there's the moment where Simba is standing out there and Mufasa appears in the cloud. And he says, basically, I'm going to paraphrase, or I'm positive I'm going to get this incorrect. But he says, you know, you have forgotten me. And Simba's like, how? And Mufasa says, you have forgotten who you are, and therefore you have forgotten me. And so that's, I hate to pull spiritual truth from The Lion King, but that is... that is exactly what we as Christians need to keep in mind with the new creation. When we forget who we are in Christ, our identity, that we're no longer the old, that we are the new, when we forget that, it's like we're forgetting Jesus Christ. Because remember, he's the one who died on the cross to give us this newness of life. So if we're not reflecting on the fact that we're brand new, it's like we've forgotten God. It's not that we don't believe in God, but it's that we don't believe that his presence is real in our life, that we're not believing the things that it says in his word. And so in order to have a relationship with God, we have to understand who we now are, what our identity is in Christ. Read with me in John, and again, this was actually mentioned. It's funny because my dad and I did not collaborate on any of this at all, but this was mentioned in Sunday school as well. But John 3, 5, and 6, Jesus describes what this new birth is. And we're not, as you're turning to John chapter 3, I want you to understand this. If you haven't read Romans 5, all humans are born spiritually dead. You see, man is comprised of three components, body, soul, and spirit. But the thing is, when Adam sinned, every single person died spiritually. And so it doesn't matter who it is, how righteous the person is, how good they think they are. Every single person has inherited spiritual deadness. And so for the unbeliever, their body and soul, but their human spirit, that element of man that connects him to God, is dead. That's what we mean when we say spiritually dead. They don't have the kind of life that God has. They don't have the spiritual life that enables them to live in God's presence. And so what does Jesus say about this in John 3, 5, and 6? He says this to Nicodemus. He says, Jesus answered in verse 5, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now you might notice something. If you have the New King James Version, Spirit there is Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is what regenerates us when we're saved. Now notice that's a capital. Now notice on in verse 6, it says this: that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit, capital letter, is spirit, little letter. And so that means when we believe in Jesus Christ for eternal life, because that's the condition to be saved, believe in him for the promise of everlasting life. He said it. He said, he who believes in me, in John 6:47, has everlasting life. And that's the one condition that man must fulfill to be saved, is believing on him. And so the idea, though, is when we believe in Jesus, our human spirit, which was dead in Adam, is revitalized and brought to new life. And it is a new creation, created new in Jesus Christ. It is a brand newness of life. That's definitely not the right grammar. But it is a newness of life in Jesus Christ by faith alone in him. And so that's a very important thing to recognize. Though we may sin, though we may still live in the flesh, we are changed. We have a new nature. We don't have to be slaves to the flesh anymore. We are a brand new creation. Though we may not always feel like it, we are a new creation. I used to run track and field. I used to work out a lot and things like that. And I used to be pretty fast at one point in time. Not anymore. But my dad used to tell me sometimes on these hard workout days, he used to say, you don't have to feel fast to be fast. And so some days you're going to wake up and you're going to say, I don't necessarily feel like a Christian. I'm feeling down on myself. But the idea with this is, it's not based on feeling. Being a Christian is based on believing in Jesus Christ for eternal life. And that doesn't change based on your feelings day in and day out. You are objectively a new creation regardless of anything. And that is irrevocable, unchangeable, a forever change. And so that is a life that is eternal. That's one very important thing to understand. And so I actually want you to go back to 2 Corinthians, if you will. But if you could jot down one of the passages that I actually referenced there, in fact, was the idea of Ephesians 2:1. Ephesians 2:1, Paul also writes about the idea of people being dead in trespasses and sins. That's what we all were before we were saved, was the idea that we were all spiritually dead in trespasses and sins. Notice what it says in 2 Corinthians 5:14 now that we're back in our primary text. It says, for the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. This is an interesting and difficult verse to interpret. If you read interpreters, you'll get about 10 different interpretations for what Paul is trying to say here. But I think with the grammar, with the wording here, it can mean only one thing. Jesus had to die for everybody on the cross. This was the substitutionary atonement. And when I say have to, I don't mean that he was obligated to, obviously, but he did it out of his great love for humanity. But the idea with this is, the doctrine of the atonement means that Jesus died for absolutely everybody. And you have to understand this truth, that if Jesus died for everybody, that means everybody at one point in time was spiritually dead. Those of us who have been brought to life at one point were spiritually dead. And so if some people were not spiritually dead, then Jesus really wouldn't have to die for everybody, would he? He would only have to die for those people who are spiritually dead. But this verse makes it clear. He died for all. And that means the entire world was in need of saving. No matter who it is, the person who does all these good and charitable deeds, all these great things, they had to have Jesus' blood cover their sins, just as all of us had to. And so, notice what the apostle says, actually, in fact, if you go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, Galatians 3:13, Paul writes about this again in Galatians 3:13. He's talking about the idea, you might have heard the word redemption. And this is a super important part of the newness of life, because this really gives us the idea of the freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. But Galatians 3:13 says this: Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. He became a curse for us that we might be redeemed. The idea of redemption or being redeemed is to buy somebody their freedom. In the Roman days, there still unfortunately existed the institution of slavery. And so if you would redeem someone, it would mean that you go into the slave market and buy someone out of their debt, whether it was an indentured servant or someone who was serving as a slave. You would buy them out from the slave market, and they would be freed from that obligation or that servitude that they were in bondage by. And so that's the importance here, that Christ has redeemed us with his blood. He has forever redeemed us and removed the curse of sin through his death on the cross. And that's the newness of life. If you go to John chapter 5, verse 24, this is the other aspect of the newness of life. And again, we got to this a little bit in Sunday school, but I really want to emphasize something. If you go to John 5, 24, Jesus says some things here about the newness of life that we have in him. And these are super important to understand. John 5, 24 says this: "Most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life." The newness of life is something you have now in Jesus Christ if you've believed in him. "And you shall not, this shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life." And this is the key. And I've mentioned this verse in different sermons. I've mentioned this in salvation messages. But this is important. Those of you who have believed in Jesus Christ have already passed from death to life. It's not like you will pass from death to life someday. If you're a really good person, you keep doing good works. No, if you believe in Jesus Christ today, you are a new creation. You have already passed from death to life. And notice the next hope. And this gives many of us hope, for those of us who have lost loved ones in this past year. Notice what verse 25 says. It says, "Most assuredly I say to you, the hour is coming and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself." So Jesus gives eternal life freely. It's an absolutely free gift. And the important thing is, and the hope we have is that number one, the newness of life is permanent. Those of us who have had this spiritual regeneration will never die spiritually. We will never die spiritually. And that's because Jesus made the promise. It's not me who maintains it. It's Jesus Christ who made the promise who maintains it. The other part of this that's super important is that not only will we never die spiritually, that even though we die physically, we will live in Jesus Christ. And that is the hope that all of us have as believers. And so as Christians, we are born again. We are forever a new creation. Paul says, if you go back to 2 Corinthians, and I love this aspect, because whenever I was a kid, I used to struggle with the idea of legalism. I used to struggle with the idea that I believed in Jesus for eternal life and I was saved. But I used to have this thought in my head that I'm never going to be good enough. I'm never going to be good enough. I got to just do all these things. Well, notice what the last part of the verse says. It says, "Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have come new." The old life is gone. We are a new creation because of who Jesus Christ is. And so what we have to understand is that understanding the new creation will transform us. In order to be transformed for Christ and have him change our life, we have to fully understand who we are in Jesus Christ as a brand new creation. The second principle from our text today is going to be found in 2 Corinthians 5, but the second principle is this: to reach our spiritual goal, we must walk in newness of life. So the first principle, if you caught this, was to understand the newness of life. Now that we've understood it, now we have to walk in it. And this is the hard part. This is the part that gets challenging. Notice what Paul says in verse 12 and 13. It says, "For we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you an opportunity to boast on our behalf, that you may have an answer for those who boast in appearance and not in heart." You see, these false teachers, they boasted in their appearance, the material things, the way that they looked, how they appeared to other people. But they didn't have their hearts right with Christ. And so Paul is going to urge his readers to believe and to walk the walk that they claim to believe. And so what it says in verse 13, it says, "For if we are beside ourselves," it means if we're crazy, like these false teachers are saying, they're saying that Paul is out of his mind. "For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. Or if we are of a sound mind, it is for you." Now notice verse 14. This is the super important part I want you to get. "For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. We've talked about the second part of that verse, but we haven't yet mentioned the first part of that verse. For the love of Christ compels us. In verse 15, and he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him, the him who died for them and rose again. So we're going to focus in on these two verses for this next principle, that we must walk in the newness of life. I want to read you a quote. Dr. Henry Morris also writes this about the Apostle Paul's compulsion, or him being compelled by the love of Christ. He says this: it is not our love for Christ that constrains us or compels us, for our love is variable at best. It changes. But his love for us, the love that took him to the cross in our place, is the greatest motivating factor in our love and service for him. So if we are going to walk in newness of life in 2021, if we are actually going to make a difference for Jesus Christ, not only do we have to understand the aspects of the new creation, but we have to be compelled by the love of Christ, just as Paul was. This is, as Henry Morris says, the most greatest motivating factor in our service and daily walk for him. Now, I want to share a Greek word with you here. Compel, if you notice in the verse there, in verse 14, that Greek word is 4911 if you're using the Strong's Concordance. And in the context, in the language here, because you have to go by context for these Greek words, you can't just necessarily take things out, but it means to urge or to impel, motivating a person to make a choice. So in order to walk in newness of life, we have to be motivated to make a choice. And what did Paul say the motivation was? What was the motivation that compels us? It's the love of Christ. Notice what it says in verse 15 now. Paul gives us a negative and a positive in verse 15. A negative and a positive doesn't mean a good and a bad. It just means we're drawing a contrast here. Notice what the beginning part says. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves. So let's talk about this for a second. The idea of living in newness of life is the idea of being compelled by the love of Christ, of him who gave himself for us. But that first of all means, walking in newness of life, first of all means that we no longer are living for ourselves, for self-advancement, focusing on the material things of this world, the things, and it is challenging with all of the trials and things that we have faced. You almost go into this idea of self-preservation, survival mode. But we have to focus in the coming year that we are not going to live for ourselves. That's the negative. And when I say negative, again, that's not a bad thing. But the positive is the second part of it. It says, but for him, this is who we live for, but for him who died for them and rose again. So we need to focus, if we want to live and walk in the newness of life, we need to live for him who died for us. So we're making choices. Whether we're going to do this or, you know, whatever it is, be out at the bar till 2 a.m. We have to think. I hate to say, what would Jesus do? But because that's the same old cliche that from the 1990s, those little wristbands. But it's the idea, and that's exactly true. We have to live with that perspective in our mind that Jesus Christ died to save us. And we have to offer our bodies a living sacrifice, as Romans 12, 1 and 2 says. And so we must be compelled by the love of Christ. We should no longer live for ourselves, but live for him. I want to share with you a passage from the book of Ephesians. If you go over there, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 4. And again, this is written by the Apostle Paul. It's interesting to compare these different letters and see the different aspects of what the Apostle Paul writes. But the Apostle Paul talks about this idea in Ephesians chapter 4, the idea of no longer living for ourselves in the flesh. And what we have to understand as we look through this is that before we were Christians, we did not have a choice. We were living in the flesh, and that was all there was. But now as believers, we have a choice. We can use our free will and volition to either serve Jesus Christ or to walk away from Jesus Christ. And so this is the purpose. We now have an option to either choose to walk in newness of life or to revert back to the flesh. And Paul exhorts his readers to walk in the newness of life. And so this is the importance, that we now have a choice, whereas before we didn't. Notice what it says in Ephesians 4:17. It says, "This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk," talking about unbelievers, "in the futility of their mind." And so Paul is urging his audience to not walk as the Gentiles walk. And you can read on in those verses if you want, but we're going to go down to verse 20. Why should they not walk as the Gentiles walk? Notice what it says in verse 20. It says, all of these things, he lists all the sins of the Gentiles, the greediness, the lewdness. He says in verse 20, "But you have not so learned Christ." And so it says, "If indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus." And so the idea with this is, we're talking about, for the second principle, walking in the newness of life. Paul said the love of Christ compels us. How can we be compelled by the love of Christ if we don't know anything about Christ? And so that's the point. How do we learn about Jesus Christ? We read his word. John 15:15, you're my friends if you do whatever I command you. How are we going to know what Jesus commands us if we're not reading his word? And so this is the idea. As we read his word more, we are more compelled by the love that he has for us. And the more we are compelled by the love that he has for us, the more we will walk in newness of life. We see this principle in Colossians 3:10. We're not going to go there, but Paul talks about, he uses the same word that he does in Ephesians 4:23. Notice what it says in Ephesians 4:23. It says, "And be renewed in the spirit." Notice the little case if you're using New King James. "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind." Paul talks about this in Colossians 3:10. He uses the same word, renewed. How does he refer to this? He says in Colossians 3:10 that they be renewed in the word. And so the idea is, we're compelled by the love of Christ the more we read the word and intake it and apply it to our life and learn to live for him. And notice one final thing in Ephesians 4 before we move on and begin to close here. But Ephesians 4 verse 22 says this, "That you put off concerning your former conduct the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts." You see, even though we are a new creation, we are still carrying around the flesh. We still live in the earthly bodies that we have. And so Paul talks about the choice that we have. We have to put off the old man, which continues. The more we live in the flesh, the more it continues to grow corrupt. The more we walk away from Christ, the easier it is to commit sins that maybe, you know, a year ago we thought this is a heinous sin. Now it's just our conscience has become numb. But notice the instruction in verse 24. It says, "And that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness." And so the new creation is perfectly righteous in Jesus Christ. The new creation, we've been imputed Jesus' righteousness. So when God sees our new life, he doesn't see all the sins and mistakes that we make. He sees the perfection of Jesus Christ. And it's that righteousness that was already given to us that we must live according to in our life. And the wording here, the idea of putting off and putting on, if you were in my Ephesians study in young adults, if you weren't, you probably have not heard this, but it's the idea in the Greek of changing an outfit. Okay, so after I preach, I kind of like to be casual. I usually change into sweatpants, a hoodie, and just kind of relax throughout the rest of the day and get ready for school the next day. But that idea of changing from one outfit into another is the idea of taking off the flesh. That's something that we play a part in. We can't just sit around as Christians and just say, "I'm not going to do anything," and expect Jesus to change my life and to bless me. No, we have to make a choice to put off the flesh and to put on the new. And so that's the second aspect that we see here. But I want to point out one final thing. If you look back at our primary text, and this is so important, because I'm hoping that through this message that we're all built up in discipleship. But this verse in 2 Corinthians 5:16, it speaks about the world and how we view the world. 2 Corinthians 5:16, this is super important because one of our goals in 2021 shouldn't be to just live for Christ, but it should be to impact this community for Christ. Notice what 2 Corinthians 5:16 says. It says, "Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, We now, yet now, we know him thus no longer. And so the important aspect of this is, before we were Christians, or before we got to spiritual maturity, we may have viewed the world differently. We might have viewed humanity differently. But as new creations in Jesus Christ, now we see the world through spiritual lenses. We have taken off the old lenses of the flesh, and that now we are a new creation. We have the ability to see the world as Christ sees it, through the love of Christ, that Jesus loved the world and died on the cross for them. Yes, there are some evil, nasty, and wicked people in this world, but Jesus Christ died for the entirety of humanity. And that's how we as Christians are called to see the outside world, not through the flesh, as Paul says, but through the newness of life. That's the lens in which we use to examine the outside world, and, might I say, to examine those within the church. When we see fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, yes, we have our disagreements. We may have small disagreements, big disagreements, but we have to see each other with grace. We have to see each other as Christ sees us. If we can do that, Paul, these words probably ring very, very true to the Corinthian church that was plagued by divisions, all sorts of things that drove them apart. We need to see those in the body of Christ through the lens that Christ sees them. This is a person who is redeemed by the blood of Christ, and we want to help all of us get to our goal of spiritual maturity, growing in Jesus Christ and impacting the world for him. And of course, we want to see the world that's lost know him and understand him and receive his gift of eternal life. And so when Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that anyone who is in Christ is a new creation, he means absolutely brand new. And you don't have to turn here, but I want to look real quick at Romans 6:4. Romans 6:4 says this, and this is a very important truth. It says, therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. So just as Jesus was raised from the dead, so we should walk in newness of life because of him who gave his life for us. So the second principle that we saw today is that we don't just understand the newness of life, we need to walk in the newness of life. So let us focus on this coming year. This should be our goal, to live for Jesus Christ, as Paul says in verse 15 of 2 Corinthians 5, to live for Jesus Christ. Jesus says in John 8:12, I am the light of the world. He who walks in me, not be in darkness, but will have the light of life. And so Jesus Christ is the only light in this dark world that we live. We live in a dark and evil world. It's filled with all kinds of suffering and violence. And the farther we get, I'm afraid to say, the closer we get to the return of Christ, the worse it's going to get. But Jesus Christ is the light. And if we're believers, we can choose to walk in that light. And I would encourage you with these words from the Apostle Paul in Philippians 3:13. In fact, I'm in the wrong book here, or in the wrong chapter. Paul says this in 3:13 of Philippians. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but only one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So, of course, we remember the trials that we faced in 2020. We remember the hardships. But as Paul says here, of course we're going to remember those things. But Paul said, I forget these things, meaning he doesn't allow them to impact his spiritual life now in the present. He is committed to living for Jesus Christ in the time in which he lived. And he says, I forget the things of the past. And I would say one final remark. If today you have not believed in Jesus Christ for eternal life, remember the promise of John 3:16. He came, God gave his only begotten son. And the idea when he says that, it means that he gave his only son to die, to take every sin of all time for all mankind to the cross, so that those who believe in him might have eternal life. Jesus Christ has promised eternal life as a free gift. In the moment you believe, he has promised that free gift to all who believe in him for it. He says in John 6:47, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. So the question is, do you believe this? Do you believe the promise of John 6:47? Because if you do, you have eternal life today. And that's my prayer for you. And I'll close us in prayer. And thank you for fellowshipping with me in the Word today.